Hello, welcome. Welcome to the YIVO Institute for Jewish Research. My name is Alex Weiser. I'm the programs manager here. As many of you, I'm sure, know, YIVO is a very special place for the contemplation of Jewish life in the past, present, and future. At the center of YIVO is our archive and library, which contains more than 23 million documents in every European language. And these documents are made available to the world through scholars coming here and working with our materials throughout the year. We have fellowships to support research, and we have professorships, and we also make our documents available to the broader public, scholars and journalists and artists, and through public programs and through exhibitions. So if you haven't yet, I suggest you check out our Sholem Aleichem exhibition, which is on the third floor. There's some very special material on display right now. So tonight, we're in for a real treat, a talk by Ken Frieden on translation in pre-Zionist Jewish literature, which really resonates with a lot of the material we have in our holdings here. So please join me in welcoming Ken Frieden to the stage.
Thank you, Sholem Aleichem. It's great to be here. I attended the advanced course decades ago, and it's good to see it's still going strong. I'm going to take us back 200 years to argue that some of the best Jewish writing then was in translation. Translation from Yiddish to Hebrew, translation from German to Hebrew, and translation from Hebrew to Yiddish. So I'll argue that translation played a key role in Jewish literary history. I'll focus on the Yiddish to Hebrew route, because Hebrew needed help from Yiddish in order to succeed as a literary language. Yiddish, you know, was already a living language of everyday life. Hebrew was used in many ways, in prayer, in study, in letters, but Hebrew, it turns out, 200 years ago, needed Yiddish. And that's something that the Hebrew literary critics have underplayed for ideological reasons. So the goal of my latest book, Travels in Translation, is to show how central Yiddish has been to the rise of Hebrew. And, the punchline is that the Israelis don't even realize that they're speaking Yiddish in translation. I'd like to start by saying that ancient Hebrew was like a ship in a bottle. It was anchored to the Hebrew Bible. And when the Berlin Jewish enlighteners at the end of the 18th century, the Haskalah, when these maskilim, the enlighteners, developed a neo-biblical style called Mlitza around 1780 to 1800, they tried to ride ancient Hebrew into the modern period, but they failed. It was really a dead end. It was the high road. It was in imitation of German classicism. So it was state-of-the-art Jewish intellectual life, 1780, Moses Mendelssohn and his disciples. But it failed in Hebrew literary history because they used a language that was not accessible to most readers at the time. To the extent that there were Hebrew readers, most Hebrew readers used a lower, more popular Hebrew style, not biblical style, a style that had been evolving gradually since the ancient period, starting with Mishnaic Hebrew and influenced by Aramaic, through medieval Hebrew and everything in between, so that the style that the maskilim tried to impose could not succeed. To jump to something that will directly interest you, I think, let me give one of the key points in this narrative. And that's an obscure narrative called Oniya Sora. It's first appeared somewhere between 1815 and 1818, probably in Ukraine, then Galicia, Zholkva. It is based on German. So based, and this is a long story, I don't think I'll go into all the detail, but there was this German enlightener, Joachim Heinrich Campe, who was very popular among the Jewish Enlightenment types in Berlin in the 1780s. He published more than a dozen travel narratives, which people thought, and the Enlighteners, the maskilim also thought, were essential to broadening the Jewish worldview, because the Jews lived too much in texts and outside geography. I begin my book with an epigram from Peretz's story, Die Teute Stadt, where he has a shtetl Jew who says, Mir Jiden leben ohne Geographie. We Jews live without geography. And in many ways, the shtetl Jews did live, excelling in textual study to the extent that they were educated, and quite weak in geography, which is part of the point, I think, of Abramovitsh's Benjamin III, when he thinks he's going to make a pilgrimage to the Holy Land and has no idea really where he's going. So travel narratives were an important genre. And they had already been an important genre for a couple hundred years in European, Western European literature. Yiddish and Hebrew caught on around 1800. And this is an example of that. So you could follow the German and the Yiddish. There's some handouts around, and it's up here too. So this is the captain speaking. So it's Bontekoe. It's a narrative he published in Dutch in 1646. It was translated into French and then into German and again into German by Campe, 1788, and then by an unknown translator. But listen to the Yiddish. To understand how radical it is, I guess you kind of have to know that Yiddish of the time often imitated German. There was a sense that literary Yiddish should sound like literary German. But this is not. This is Ukrainian Yiddish, and it sounds, I think it sounds pretty natural. And it's important that it's first person, trying to capture the voice of a captain who's not a literary person, so plain style. Ich hab mich erschrocken, sagt Bontekoe in seiner Reisebeschreibung. And it's direct translation from the German, but it's Yiddishized, and it's good Yiddish. Und bin herabgelaufen. So I was shocked. I was, says Bontekoe in his narrative, his travel narrative, and ran down. This is when the ship has caught fire. Wie ich bin herabgekommen, habe ich gesehen, als der Häufen Keulen in ganzen ist schon gar in hellish fire geworden. And when I went down, I saw that the pile of coals totally had become a hellish fire. It's a little different from the German, but it's lively, successful Yiddish. I don't need to belabor the point, I think. I just wanted to give you sort of the culmination in showing how travel and translation culminate in very powerful literary language that was almost impossible to find at this time. And so it's through German and through Yiddish. Just to go back to the maritime, nautical connections, Jews were not known as mariners, but we have the book of Jonah, and there's a short passage in Psalm 107 referring to sea travel. What's interesting is Hebrew biblical vocabulary is already quite limited, and then when you get even tighter to a very specific technical area like sea travel, it's an even smaller realm. So by virtue of such a small vocabulary around this topos of sea travel, it's possible to do almost carbon dating of the Hebrew and Yiddish that gets used, because there are words for things like sail and mast, aspects of ships, even the word for ship. There's Oniya in the Bible mostly, and Sfina, mostly post-biblical. You can really tell a lot just from the language. And we'll get into that some more. But I just wanted to mention the biblical precursors. Also, we're talking, when we talk about travel narratives in the pre-modern period, usually, if it's Jews, it's pilgrimages to the Holy Land. So that's a sub-motif of my book, that we go through centuries of pilgrimage narratives where the goal really is not to see something new. The goal is to have read scripture and to try to impose scripture on reality, to go to the holy place and find what they already know is supposed to be there, to confirm what they know from scripture. So, for example, they'll go to the Dead Sea and see a pillar of salt, and they'll say, I saw the pillar of salt that Lot's wife was turned into. Or they'll see the Temple Mount and make certain comments thinking that the temple was still there. It's an example of imposing text on reality instead of seeing reality. Some highlights, Meshulam of Volterra, Ovadia of Bertinora, they were Italian Jews. Meshulam was a jeweler, but well-educated. Ovadia of Bertinora was a well-known rabbi. They write a very interesting Hebrew, but when it gets to sea travel, they just don't have the words. They end up using nautical words straight from Italian, just showing that Hebrew wasn't able to convey that those realia. Then something new starts to happen in the mid-18th century. I'm calling it folk Hebrew. These aren't the only authors, but in travel narratives, there are two excellent examples. Starting to use a Hebrew that's not trying to be biblical and that's not full of Italian. It's Yiddish inflected. And that's basically the motif that I'm going to follow now, is the Yiddish inflected Hebrew. So, as you may know, there was a burst of Hasidic publishing, two seminal texts in 1814, 1815, with first Shifrei Abesht in praise of the Baal Shem Tov, came out right at the end of 1814. It was a bestseller, sold thousands of copies, and was immediately translated into three different Yiddish versions, and there were other Hebrew editions that came out. So Shifrei Abesht is in praise of the Baal Shem Tov. It's stories about the Baal Shem Tov, the so-called founder of Hasidism. And they're popular tales. They were clearly collected from the folk in Yiddish. But since Hebrew was the accepted literary language and the status language, it was put out first in Hebrew. Then, by popular demand, there were several translations. But there was basically not enough respect for Yiddish as a literary language to encourage putting out an original in Yiddish of such an important book about the great Hasidic leader. It's a fascinating text in Hebrew and in Yiddish. I didn't get to Hebrew for a while until I was on sabbatical once in Europe, and my books were sent to me by mistake by surface mail instead of airmail. So I had a very small collection, and one of them was a Yiddish version of Shifrei Abesht. And finally I began to understand the Hebrew by realizing it really is Yiddish written in Hebrew. I won't go into that, but I'll do it with a more obvious example, which is Nachman's Tales. Now, they're still being read 200 years later and gaining adherence. What's not often realized is that Nachman didn't write his tales. Nachman told his tales in Yiddish. His scribe, Nathan Sternharz, wrote them down. And there's even a passage, I think I have it on the next slide, where Nathan Sternharz describes how he did that. And it's pretty fascinating. Basically, in 1802, then 1803, he became close. Sternharz came from a Misnagdic family, a non-Hasidic family, had a very strong Hebrew education, but was missing something, felt something was lacking. So he went with a friend and met Nachman, and soon Nachman realized his power as a writer and drew him closer. So I'm just going to read a few lines at the the last four lines of this passage, and I'm going to read it in the prevailing Sephardic Israeli style. V'kach haya derech k'tivati. This was the manner of my writing, lifana, before him, before Nachman. She'atoira, the Torah, she'amar ba'oto ha'et, that he spoke at that time, k'mo b'Shabbat Chanukah, as in the Shabbat of Chanukah. Chazar ha'kach ba'et ha'k'tiva. He went back at the time of writing, v'amara lifanai, and said it before me, piska piska, paragraph by paragraph, she'amar lifanai, kama diburim b'lashon Ashkenaz, that he spoke before me a few verses or words in Ashkenazic, that's Yiddish, v'ani yashavti lifanav katavti hadavarim b'lashon hakodesh. And I sat before him and I wrote them in Lashon Kodesh. It's quite remarkable. I mean, why not just write it down in Yiddish? Again, because Yiddish didn't have the status, acceptance as a language of sacred text. So it wouldn't have looked good just to but it's sort of funny because then Nachman wanted it to appear in Yiddish, so he had there was also a Yiddish translation. This is after Nachman's death. Nachman died in 1810, and he wanted there to be a bilingual edition, so the traditional editions always have had Hebrew on top and Yiddish on the bottom. I put them side by side so you can compare. This is from Tale 6, one of my favorites, Tale of the King and the Wise Man, or sometimes called the Tale of the Humble King. And what I want to point out is that the Hebrew is so Yiddishized and the Yiddish is so Hebrewized that essentially Sternharz has broken down the wall between Hebrew and Yiddish. And that's the way it should be, because Jews were living in Hebrew and Yiddish. And it's true, most women didn't study Hebrew at the time, and many men also were not that educated and didn't have strong Hebrew. But the two languages and literatures developed alongside one another, and you really see it here. So this is a text that Nachman narrated orally in Yiddish, but then had it written down in Hebrew, and then later translated back into Yiddish. So Sternharz says that he had to draw the Hebrew down because he wanted the Hebrew to be closer to the original Yiddish. And then when they did the Yiddish, they had to draw the Yiddish up to make it more like the Hebrew. So you'll see that. So I'll start with the Yiddish, Maise, a story, right? A melech is gevein, right? And it's almost like the Hebrew is transparently Yiddish. Maase b'melech echad, v'hayalo hacham. Right? There was a king, and he had a wise man, and a melech, der melech hot kahat achochem. And so many words, so the Hebrew is infused with words that are already familiar to Yiddish speakers, and the Yiddish is infused with Hebrew. Let's see, if I point to it, I'll just be able to show you where we are. Hot sich der Melech angerufen zum Chochem. So the king called to the Chochem, to the wise man, and it's the same, Ama Melech la Chacham, same words, right? Same vocabulary. Ba'asher sheyesh melech shechotem atzmo shehu gibor gadol ve'ish emet v'anav. So that's the description of the king, the hidden king. He says, ba'asher, same connective word. Sefahanin a melech, there's a king. Vos'er chotem zich, he signs himself, same the Hebrew word. As there is a grosser gibor, a great hero, in the Hebrew, right? And it's also Vura is one of the sefirot in the Kabbalistic tree. Un ish emes, and a man of truth. Un an anav, and a humble person. Okay, it's Yiddish so full of Hebrew that, well, as I said, the wall is falling between Hebrew and Yiddish. Again, I don't need to go into the details because I want to leave time to discuss this. I hope this is somewhat provocative because the Hasidim have been cut out of literary history for the most part because of ideological bias. What could they contribute to modern literature? But what I think I've shown in my book, and just briefly touching on now, is how the Hasidim, in fact, were avant-garde users of Hebrew and Yiddish. They're at a time when maybe because of the bias of late 18th century neoclassicism, certain high rhetoric, pre-romantic, there were followers of that in Hebrew and Yiddish, whereas after romanticism, that fell by the wayside in a lot of literature. So the Hasidim actually, by being the new agey types of their time, were avant-garde, and they were also folk writers who reached far more readers than anybody else at the time. Now, lest you think that Nathan Sternharz, the scribe, was just a scribe or just a translator, he did more, and it wasn't just theoretical. He was a very interesting, powerful narrator of his own independent narratives. And this text is not widely known. It's Seder HaNisiya Shelo L'Eretz Yisrael. It appeared in the back of the initial 1815 edition of the Tales by Nachman. Hidden in the back was this account of Nachman's pilgrimage to the Holy Land from 1798-99. Koidem Shenasa L'Eretz Yisrael. Before he went to Eretz Yisrael, before he went to the land of Israel, Hayaba Kamenetz, he was in Kamenetz. To me, it reads like Yiddish. And his nesia, his trip to Kamenetz, was a great appella. It was a great wonder. Kipitom nasa mi beto, plutzling is like a phone from sein von der heim. Suddenly left his house. Ve'amar sheyesh lo derech lichanav linsoa, and said that he had a path before him to travel. Now, of course, Hebrew is a Semitic language, but rabbis, in the 1,000 years of strong Jewish cultural presence in Central Europe, Jews were speaking mostly Yiddish, also German to the west later on, and Slavic languages later on to the east. But essentially what happened, and here I agree with the linguist Gilad Zuckerman, essentially Hebrew turned into a European language. Hebrew as it was being used. That's what the Enlighteners probably wanted to avoid. They were purists. They wanted to stick by biblical grammar and so on, which wasn't viable because languages have lives of their own and you can't prescribe to that extent. So what we end up with is a style that really caught on among the Hasidim, a narrative style that was barely possible in Hebrew at the time. There's almost nothing like it. You can look. I mean, I've been looking. And travel narratives, I found, is the best place to look. So I wanted to see, not just among the Hasidim, but other writers, and I want to show you that too. So first, just also for some comic relief, Nathan Sternharz also wrote his own pilgrimage narrative. He traveled in the footsteps of his Rebbe in 1822. It wasn't published till much after his lifetime. There were two parts. First part published in 1876. Second part not until 1903-1904. But there are manuscripts which show that it's original, that it hasn't been falsified or heavily edited. So in this, I just wanted to show you that he's able also to narrate his own independent account. It's not just that he was the Rebbe's scribe, sort of like Plato to Socrates. He's been undervalued, and I guess in the interest of time, I'll jump to the comic part, which is this amazing scene. It's in Hebrew. There's not a Yiddish version. He was phenomenal Hebrew stylist. So bear in mind, this is almost 200 years ago, and it can be read comfortably today, which is not true of the Enlighteners. The Enlightenment authors wrote poetry, philosophy. No one reads that. This can be read today, I think. So, Kol Yom Gimel, of a Kol Yom Gimel Hanal. All of that Tuesday, as mentioned above, the sea was calmer. We returned to our strength. Okay, and then I want to go to, the captain pulls out an instrument. Okay, here, so second line, so I'm here. Sorry, here we go. Right, betchilat alayla. In the beginning of the evening, itchil hakapitan, they don't have the Hebrew words necessarily, the captain began to play, and again, al eze klezmer, he began to play on some musical instrument. V'sha'aloti imani yachol nagen, and he asked me if I could play. I answered, hishavti lo, I said no. V'diber imi mi'inyan klezmer, and he talked to me about the matter of musical instruments. V'hitchalti l'daber imam mi'inyan rikudin, and I spoke with them about the matter of dances, shebenenu, among us, the Jews. Because the sailors, the captain, they're always non-Jews. Muhagdim, we dance biyontev on holidays, valchazana and on a wedding. Betoch kach yiradati el habayit. I went down in the meanwhile to the house. He means the hold. Betoch kach nitoraru hem v'itchil alif mihem lirkod. So in meantime, they were aroused and one of them began to dance. Harbe, a lot. V'azai nitorer, Reb Yehuda, his friend, he was traveling with, what was his name? Yehuda, I forgot, it's Yehuda Eliezer, that's it. Yehuda Eliezer. He's also his friend, he's his travel companion. The two Jews were among all these sailors. And he started dancing too, Gamken, Ketzat. V'harkach yarad, he came down and served me in my meal, Suda, okay, and then I'm just going to jump a little bit. And when he finished the meal, he said, Reb Yehuda Eliezer said, "Sheyesh lecheshek lirkod." He had desire to dance some more. Valinu alas fina, he means the deck. We now use fina as boat, but it comes from a root meaning deck. So he went up to the deck. Kapitan im od alef, the captain with one other, hayu menagnin, they were playing. Be'eze kleshir, some instrument, pshutim, instruments, simple instruments, and Reb Yehuda Eliezer, haya meraked, he was dancing, harbe, ma'od, a whole lot, ad she, achar kach, gam ani, gam kadati ani, I also danced with Rabbi Yehuda Eliezer, and also two of the matrosin, two of the sailors were dancing. It's an amazing scene, going back to 1822, and it's amazing Hebrew, I think, by virtue of being implicitly a translation from Yiddish. It's in very simple and straightforward Hebrew that was accessible in a genre that was familiar, that is pilgrimage narrative. Now I want to say more about the other camp, that is the enlighteners. You probably know Joseph Perl, 1819, published Revealer of Secrets, which was a satire and a parody against the Hasidim, because the standard line of the enlighteners was what the Hasidim are doing is problematic from all kinds of standpoints, and the Hebrew itself is corrupt, is barbaric. It sounds too much like Yiddish. So the joke is on Perl, though, because Perl, when he wrote in his own voice, is almost impossible to read today. No one reads his works. The only thing we read is his parody of the Hasidim, where he tried to sound like the Hasidim. So in fact, he ended up serving as a conduit, helping carry over Hasidic style into literary Hebrew. I want to show that, though, Perel was not the only one. In fact, Perel had a mentor, Mendel Lefin, and he's the hero of my book, Mendel Lefin. He also was known as a Yiddishist. He translated Proverbs into Yiddish, 1814. Very important text because he used the style of everyday Ukrainian Yiddish, and that was not at the time. Well, first of all, it was not common for an enlightener to use Yiddish at all. But then using it, he used it in a remarkable way, actually conveying. He was very sophisticated as a linguist, even though, I mean, he was not trained as a linguist. Just to briefly say something about Lefin. So he came from Ukraine, Satanov, born 1749. In about 1781, he went to Berlin, supposedly because of an eye ailment. And he got to know Moses Mendelssohn and other of the leading enlighteners in Berlin. He didn't approve of some of their looser ways, and he returned to Ukraine, and he didn't follow their example of writing in German. He continued to write in Hebrew and Yiddish. So when he wrote in Hebrew, he also didn't agree with the enlighteners of trying to write in this obscure pseudo-biblical style. He used basically a rabbinic style, Mishnaic and rabbinic style, with some Yiddish influences. So very interesting that at the end of his life, he was living in Tarnopol with Perel. He was Perel's mentor, and they, I think Perel supported him at the end of his life. He influenced. So Lefin is the sort of unacknowledged hero of Hebrew literature and Yiddish literature. So now I want to explain how he also produced remarkable Hebrew narrative 200 years ago. And this is, keep in mind, it's two generations before the Zionists always say, you know, we revived Hebrew, right? The tehiya, the revival of Hebrew, supposedly happened in the 1880s, 1890s, with Zionism, with Mendele Moykher Sforim. So I always knew that the grandfather must have had grandfathers. So I found him. Mendel Lefin is the grandfather of the grandfather, because Abramovitsh was called the grandfather of modern Yiddish literature. Lefin had students and disciples who taught at the Zhytomyr Rabbinical School, and in fact, Abramovitsh, Mendele, was a student of them. So it, really, there's a genealogy. But in terms of what Lefin produced in narrative, he also caught the travel narrative bug. But instead of doing pilgrimage narratives, he wanted to broaden the Jewish worldview. Going back, he didn't want parrots to be right at saying that we Jews live without geography. He wanted to teach Jews geography. And that was following recommendations by Wesley and others who said we should learn secular subjects. So what does he do? He had been in Berlin in the 1780s when Campe was a big bestseller with his travel narratives. So he translated two of them into really excellent Hebrew. So alongside the Oniya that I mentioned before, he took one that was from English, had been published in 1783. A trip by the East India Company from 1783, published 1788. George Keat. It's a remarkable narrative on its own terms. It's kind of a noble savage story because the British shipwreck in Palau, few hundred miles east of the Philippines, a virtually unknown island. It's now a destination for scuba divers because of the reef, and that's exactly why the British shipwrecked there, because of the reef. So there's this narrative that Campe produced from the English, 1791. Lefin took that and translated it into really a tour de force of Hebrew in 1818. It's less Yiddishized than the Hasidic Hebrew, but to my mind, it's a direct answer to the Hasidim. If you keep in mind, Perel and his circle were taken aback that in 1814, 1815, the Hasidim were drawing thousands of readers to their book about the great Baal Shem Tov or fantasy tales by the Rebbe. They wanted to do something else and something real, get real, you know? Not these hagiographic tales or these wonder maises, but actual narratives of world exploration. Not only that, to expand the worldview beyond a world in which Torah was at the center and Zion was at the center. This is, of course, enlightenment, to modernize and bring the Jews into the modern world. So I have an English example, which I won't dwell on, but just to show that it's a gripping narrative about the shipwreck. The man who was on the lookout called Breakers, but so short was the notice that the call of Breakers had scarce reached the officer upon the deck before the ship struck. The horror and dismay this unhappy event threw everybody into was dreadful. And this is the original English from 1788. The captain and all those who were below in their beds sprang upon deck in an instant, anxious to know the cause of this sudden shock to the ship and the confusion above. A moment convinced them of their distressed situation. The breakers alongside, through which the rocks made their appearance, presented the most dreadful scene and left no room for doubt. Very graphic narrative and a challenge for Hebrew at this time when there, you know, there wasn't a living language. So how do you do that? So I give an example of Kampa's Hebrew in the next slide. It's not as Yiddishized, but bear with me. So, betoch shah mu'etet hitkadru shamayim. So in a short time, and you got the German there, if you know German. So in not very long time, the skies darkened, became gloomy, ba'avim, with clouds, hashuchim, it's dark clouds. And there was aroused a great mehuma, tumult or something. Shalgishamim, ra'amim, v'barakim, of rains and thunder and lightning. Pitom nishma tz'aka hatzofe barosh hatoran. Suddenly was heard a cry by the scout at the head of the mast, saying, Mishperei galim, mishperei galim. Breakers, breakers. Ba'oto rega mamash nitrafa tzvina b'koach gedol el ha'sela. At the exact moment, really, the ship struck up against, with great force, up against the boulder. Rad v'bahala achaza kol ha'am. Trembling and fear gripped all of the people. V'gam rabba chovel. He's got the word for captain, the biblical word. And even the captain, asher nirdam, who had fallen asleep in the depth of the ship, language that comes from Jonah. So I think it was a breakthrough. This is, just as a curiosity, some images of the original English, since it's in the English language. This is a later edition. Nancy Sinkov opined that some of these stories, when they tell about the native peoples, it's also a little bit parallel to the Enlighteners talking about the less educated peoples of Eastern Europe. And so the educational goals that they sought to fulfill, they may have sort of brought into that the narrative of the British going to the island of Palau or Pelu. And just some more images, since they're so remarkable. This Captain Wilson invested with the Order of the Bone. It's very remarkable. I mean, the Bontuku is different, which I mentioned before. The Bontuku is much more, we're the colonizers and they're the savages. And in fact, Bontuku worries about, he thinks that a few of his people have been eaten on the island of Samoa. But in fact, his people also have been threatening to eat each other because they're starving at sea after the shipwreck. But this is different because this is kind of a noble savage narrative from 1788. Real effort at mutual understanding. There are some problems with that, but that's the official line that Keat, the author of the narrative, gave. And this is sort of interesting too because this is the chief, Abatullah, on location, and this is his son who decides he wants to go back with the British to London and learn all of these great things that they have, and they civilize him. It's kind of interesting etchings in the original edition. I guess we view that with a much more cynical eye today than 200 years ago. But what's interesting is how world-related it is. And this is sort of another angle of travel narratives that I've pushing for in my latest research. I think what Jews have always done best is textual. I mean, we're great textualists, maybe as compensation for losing political power, who knows, for being in exile. But we preserve the Torah, we preserve texts, we're great commentators, sometimes to the detriment of the relationship to reality. So for the first time in this book, I include maps and portraits, and it's a book about pulling the ship out of the bottle. I started by saying Hebrew was like a ship in a bottle. And it was for these writers to get beyond pilgrimage narrative, which stays within the text in many ways, as I tried to say, right? The pilgrimage narrative tries to travel, but only to find what we already know from the text, from the sacred text. We're going to the Holy Land, which we know from the sacred text. These narratives go beyond, try to show the shtetl Jews that there is a world out there, that it's not everything is determined by Torah and not everything centers around Jerusalem. The other narrative I mentioned, Bontuku, and this, though it's 1646, and it's not clear who the translator was, but just wanted to mention it's not a unique phenomenon with Lefin. There were other peoples in his circle who attempted to use Hebrew in as lively a way as the Hasidim were using it. It's a culture war. It's a battle of the books where the Hasidim were winning because the Hasidim had reached the masses through their hagiographic, especially the Baal Shem Tov stories, hagiographic tales, wonder tales about the great Rebbe. They were winning the culture war. And so the counter was some of these. And it's also a remarkable reception history going from Dutch into French into German and then into Hebrew and Yiddish. I didn't tell you the gripping narrative of that ship, but in brief, it's a survivalist story. Basically, Bontuku, it's a merchant ship of the Dutch East India Company, and what happened was that one night the steward apprentice went down to the hold to get breakfast for the next morning, which consisted of brandy. So he ladling out the brandy from a keg, and part of the wick of a candle falls in and ignites the barrel. And there's a big cry of fire. This is the passage that I read to you before. There was a lot of gunpowder on board because that's what they did for defense of these merchant ships. And according to Bontuku's narrative, he was still on board when this ship exploded. He describes this, and then half the crew had already abandoned ship in two lifeboats. Then we get a survivalist narrative. And I want to say something else about that. Mendel Lefin and the other Enlighteners saw in that a moral value to educate people into the virtues of perseverance, survival in adversity, making do, and also teamwork even. These remarkable scenes of surviving for 2 or 3 weeks at sea with almost no food, and so on. So these are gripping narratives that are almost like novels, but they, you know, the Enlighteners were not big fans of fiction, of novels. It's sort of a little bit like the Common Core today, where we're being told that students should read more nonfiction. And they were like that too. They didn't think that fiction was a good influence. They thought this fantasy stuff was a bad influence. So these travel narratives were an attempt to return the Jews to reality, an attempt to bring Hebrew into modernity, and at the same time Yiddish, using Yiddish for everyday things, not just commentaries, Jewish law, or Bubba Maiseis, but actual captain's logs and actual tales, confronting the world with all the realia. Which brings me to my final point. I mean, I have some other conclusions, but about referentialism. I said, I think the Jews have always been good at textualism, but returning to reference, returning to using Hebrew in contact with reality. Of course, it came about in the 19-teens and 1920s in Palestine, but when it came about, it did much the same thing as the Hasidim did 100 years before that, which is basically people were speaking in translation, the way immigrants usually do. So people were speaking Hebrew very much as a translation from Yiddish. And so, in fact, again, it's sort of, it may not have been a direct influence, but it was sort of a repetition of the same phenomenon when Hebrew finally did really become a living language on location. It did so in translation. And that's why Israelis, I mean, have been blocked from seeing that they're actually speaking Yiddish. Really, there are many terms. I could give you many examples of Hebrew words that went into Yiddish and changed their meaning. And then we sent them back into Hebrew with the new meaning. There are dozens or even hundreds of words that used in Hebrew today are colored by Yiddish. And even Uriel Weinreich wrote about that phenomenon, and it's very interesting. We could talk more about it. I'll just end with some conclusions, and I hope you have some questions. I hope I provoked you a little bit. Just to say that I think that these C narratives show the complex and roundabout pathways of literary influence. Sometimes a translation is more original than the original, because in English or German or Dutch, there were many travel narratives by captains. But in Yiddish and Hebrew, there were basically none of that kind. So the genre itself was new. So translating some of these travel narratives was a radically innovative phenomenon in genre and language. So these are remarkable instances of reception history in literary history, and translation played such a major role. Also wanted to point out how a minority culture like the Jews in Eastern Europe appropriated a genre from a more powerful group. And that's interesting. In some cases, I think it's maybe popular to say that colonization damages the local culture. But in this case, I would say, since the Jews maybe were already quite literary and literate, I don't think it damaged Hebrew and Yiddish culture. I think both were enriched by the influence of other European languages and literatures and genres like travel narratives. Of course, there were no novels in Yiddish. It's hard to say exactly when it starts in Yiddish and Hebrew, but before 1800, there were no novels, and novels were already an established European genre. So we have a modern Jewish literature basically by virtue of cultural transfer, by imitation, parody, modulation, adaptation of a European form. As I said, translation itself can be extremely original. I like to talk about innovation by translation. Translation is often not secondary at all. And finally, as I alluded to before, that the grandfather also had a grandfather, that it's long been popular since Sholem Aleichem and Bialik to say that Abramovitsh Mendele Moykher Sforim was the great grandfather of modern Jewish or modern Yiddish literature. But the grandfather also had pre-Zionist grandfathers like Mendel Lefin. Thank you. So I hope there's some reaction. I hope I was a little provocative. Yes. The Enlightenment or Mitnagdism also. There's really three movements, the Enlighteners, the opponents of the Hasidim, and the Hasidim. So two parts of your question I hear. Thank you for the questions. The first was about the biblical origins of Jewish travel narratives, which is certainly true that the Jews were a wandering people, and there are the Exodus. I mean, there are many tribal narratives in biblical texts. The difference, I think, has to do with realia. And I mean, this kind of concreteness is not something you get in biblical narrative. If you look closely, and there's a great critic already from 60 years ago, Eric Auerbach, who wrote a famous article, Odysseus' Scar, comparing Greek literature to biblical literature, saying that the Hebrew Bible is fraught with background, whereas Greek narrative always brings things to the foreground and shows the detail, whereas Hebrew narrative leaves things obscure, and he gives the example of Abraham and Isaac. So much is left unspoken, and which leaves room for lots of commentary, so all of our midrash commenting. But there's a style of concreteness that I think is lacking from Hebrew literature in most biblical texts. I mean, I'm sure someone can find counterexamples. Then in Talmudic texts tend to be more concrete. The Gemara with the Aramaic, I mean, that was a living language. Aramaic was the lingua franca of the time. So the Talmud does have realia, everyday things. The second part of your question, now I forgot. Yes, well, that's a suggestion that Nancy Sinkoff made in her excellent book, Out of the Shtetl, that, and also Moshe Pelli. They speculated that these enlighteners who were reading and writing about explorers discovering native peoples were somehow indirectly, maybe allegorically, talking about themselves in relation to the shtetl Jews, who they were trying to civilize. That's an interesting speculation. I'm not sure we can ever prove that, but there's something to it. Yes?
Thank you for the wonderful talk. I have a comment. I don't know if you are considering this also from the viewpoint of translation studies. So your talk reminds me of Itamar and Zohar's polycystic view.
Yes. Thank you. Yeah, let me try to repeat some of that. It's going into some pretty technical literary theory from Tel Aviv, Itamar Evan Zohar. You're probably a student of Hannah Kronfeld.
No, I'm a student of translation.
Oh, okay, but because I don't know how widely his yeah, it's remarkable theory, and it was very influential in Tel Aviv since the 1970s. Polysystem theory, it's called. Maybe. I can't translate that word, but looking at systems, I mean, it's influenced by structuralism, so systems of language and literature. And he does have one article, I don't know if you know, where he talks about the role of translation. And you know that article? So it's one chapter in his longer monograph, the role of translation in the literary system. And since he knew Russian, he's aware of the influence of Russian on Hebrew, and he's aware of the influence of Yiddish on Hebrew. So he's one of the few critics who was able to do that. There's one article from 1968 that shows the influence of Yiddish. Sort of people have talked about in Mendeley and the Hebrew-Yiddish influences back and forth. But yes, I thank you. I am trying to say that Hebrew and Yiddish are not separate polysystems. Why should they be? With Arabic, people say, you know, there's diglossia of the high literary Arabic and then the everyday spoken Arabic. Our diglossia was Hebrew and Yiddish. So it was, I mean, that is, Ashkenazic Jews have an interlinguistic diglossia, which is quite remarkable. And what's even more remarkable is how they get brought together. I mean, the maskilim were trying to keep them apart because they scorned Yiddish. The Hasidim naturally put them together, as I show, though the greater status of Hebrew meant that they mostly published in Hebrew. And then, it took another two generations for Yiddish to get on its feet, and it also for Hebrew to be more widely recognized. There's also a kind of accidental reason for that, which is that in Tsarist Russia, there was a clamping down on Hebrew publication. It was much harder to publish in Hebrew after 1823. So there's a gap in there. And that's also why some of Nathan Sternhardt's writings weren't published until the 1870s. But which is really interesting because that's the period of reform after Alexander II. It's also when Peretz gets going, and he read them. And Peretz then produces neo-Hasidic writings influenced by Hasidic writings. And it's interesting, he might not have known them as recently. I mean, they came out in the 1870s when Peretz was reading a lot and coming across these things for sure. It's clear that he read them. So that's the point that I think a lot of Israeli critics have missed, not wanting to see how important Hasidic writing was. And again, Bialik had no great love for Yiddish. So he, in his view of Mendeley, of Abramovitsh, he wanted him to write more Hebrew. He also admired Peretz's Hebrew writings, tried to get Peretz to publish more Hebrew. And Peretz did have excellent Hebrew because he wrote as a Hebraist. He wrote as a Hebraist who mostly wrote Yiddish, and so when he wrote Hebrew later, his later Hebrew is amazing because he's thinking in Yiddish and publishing in Hebrew, and it's a really interesting Hebrew that hasn't been adequately recognized. But thank you. Yes, breaking down the wall. Bialik says that Abramovitsh did that, but in fact he didn't mean it because he keeps them very separate. Bialik does. Yes.
I think they're in an unfortunate geography, a retarded geography in terms of literature. I mean, the father of Russian literature is Pushkin in 1820. Germans, Goethe, 1830.
Well, no, before. Goethe already, Werther is already 1870s, 1880. It's early. 1770s, Werther. So, yeah, it's really early. So,
that's a late early. Then, you know, the Danes, Anderson, the Finns, these are 1810s, 1820s, 1830s, for their golden, surge of creative fictional ideas. Of course, look at England, France, Spain, Portugal, Italy. I mean, that's where it's rich. That's where it's really coming from. The imagination.
No, I think you're underestimating the importance of 18th century novels. I mean, 1719 already is Defoe's Robinson Crusoe.
English.
Yeah, English. But they were translated into German and Russian, so they were received. And we have British epistolary novels in the 1750s.
English.
But it all gets received through Germany and France and... So the educated, the maskilic, the enlightened authors knew about them and read them in German. I'm not sure, your first comment was they're suffering from their isolated geography, which is partly true. I mean, so in Russia, Russia also was belated. Russia has, right, was later. And all the more remarkable that you could have these writers in Ukraine publishing such interesting narrative in Hebrew and Yiddish in 1815, 1818. I think. Sheva, I saw.
So could you give us some examples of the Hebrew words that went into Yiddish and then came out again?
I thought someone might ask that, so I brought a list. I have here in my hand. One example is Efsha. So the way we use it in Yiddish is different from the way it... I won't go into detail, but Efsha. So it's just a different grammar. Let's see.
But it comes back into Hebrew.
It's used in Hebrew that way sometimes, and in the primary position. Because efshar la'asod, it's possible to do something. And I know I've heard Israelis also use it in a way that wouldn't correspond to their original grammar, but rather to the Yiddish grammar. Batlin, the word batlin, which It's a good Hebrew word, but in Yiddish it came to mean beggar, and it goes back into Hebrew as beggar. Lots of the words Baal this, Baal that, right? We have it, of course, Baal Chalom is master of dreams, which is Joseph, but there are lots of Balabus. So the use of that, Balagula, coachman, Balabus, right, householder, Balagula, coachman. These are Hebrew phrases that were popularized in Yiddish and then go back into modern Hebrew through the Yiddish. It's naturally because, in fact, Yiddish kept Hebrew alive. Yiddish had thousands of words of Hebrew actively being used for 1,000 years, of European Jewish history. And then the Zionists came along and threw away the latter and said, we're going to return to biblical Hebrew. Not acknowledging that, in fact, it's continuous. There's no new, you can't start a new language. They tried with Esperanto. You can't start anew. You always move forward. So, hevre. Israelis will say hevre for like guys, folk. And we have it in Yiddish in different ways. But hevra is society. Hevre is gang. And that comes through Yiddish. Often the Israelis will use an Ashkenazic pronunciation of some of these things to indicate that it's a different meaning. It's the Ashkenazic meaning of the word, but not always. A maven, they have the word maven, right? Mevin is to understand, and we know from Yiddish, a maven is an expert. How about a chacham, right? Or etzes, don't give me any of your etzes. It's Hebrew, but it means something different. Or chachmas, don't give me your chachmas, your wise stuff. I can show you a list. I have many examples. So yes, so the Israelis are speaking Yiddish without knowing it. I saw some other hands. Yes, Alan. Yes. Yes.
So, number one, who was reading them? How widely were they read? And were they, being as they are, kind of secular culture?
Yes.
Were they a gateway drug
Thank you. That's a really interesting question about who was reading the secular travel literature? So, we do know that they were pretty widely published because they were reprinted several times. The first big one is 1807. That was not. That sort of sank, but it influenced other people. So the 1815 to 18 Oniya Sorah was reprinted a couple times in Vilna. It probably was first printed in Ukraine in Vilna, partly because that's where you were allowed to publish Hebrew, Vilna and Zhytomyr. It was reprinted, a little bit cleaned up. So there was a demand. Apparently there was a demand for these narratives. It was good literature. People wanted something good to read. And also Mendel Lefin's Masot Hayam, Sea Tales, published 1815, when things loosened up with Hebrew publishing, it was reprinted in 1859 and then later. Actually, there's an interesting story, let me just mention about that. Because they became quite rare. These are little chapbooks for the most part. They're little thin volumes and they tend to decompose. So there aren't many copies left. In many cases, I was working with the only copy. Oniya Sorah that I mentioned, the Hebrew Yiddish version, there's only one known copy. It's in Jerusalem, and it's missing the opening pages, which is part of why we're not sure who wrote it. There's only one copy. But Masot Hayam by Lefin is really the most important example. And until a few months ago, I thought there was only one copy in the world in Jerusalem. But thanks to Google Books, I found another copy a few months ago in Vienna, cataloged under the wrong author's name and the wrong title. But because I searched some of the key words, the book came up, and I found it. So I have the missing 16 pages. So they've become extremely rare. But they were reprinted, which shows that they weren't just oddities that nobody really cared about. There was an audience. And we know there was an audience, too, from the widespread distribution of Hasidic literature. both in Hebrew and in Yiddish. So there were readers, and there was pretty widespread literacy among Jews, and so they wanted something good to read on Shabbos.
So they were cheap editions?
So I don't have exact information about how much they cost. I know that Sholem Aleichem, that's much later, there were, you know, 5 ruble editions or very cheap editions in Sholem Aleichem's time, but I don't know about these early chapbooks. Publishing, I don't know. I don't have that information. Yes? Let's start down below and move up. Yes.
Like
right. Right. Well, that's a whole other topic, which I can't get into, but it is interesting how translation continued to play a role in the 20th century. There's some books about that. There's one interesting book about how European drama was translated into Hebrew in the 20th century. Interestingly, because, of course, drama should sound oral, should sound like real speech. So how do you do that into Hebrew? It was a real challenge. So interesting. How do you translate European drama into Hebrew when Hebrew is just becoming a spoken language? So you're right, though. Translation, again, becomes a key issue at several stages in Jewish... Yes, Habima. I think you might mean the play by Jacob Gordon, which is around 1904.
I'm talking about translation into Hebrew, your real course of
Okay. Could be, yeah, all right. Yeah, so translation, yeah, and there were translations of Mystère de Paris, was very popular in Hebrew in the mid 19th century. Yes, now further in the back. Good question. It's been debated. There are some accounts of people claiming that Jewish communities in the Ottoman Palestine would sometimes speak Hebrew on Shabbat. And there's some evidence of it even in Sternharz. So from 1822, from his account, he says when he was making his pilgrimage, and he couldn't talk to anybody because he doesn't know Arabic, he tried to use Hebrew with some of the Jews he met in Alexandria or in the Holy Land. He says that they couldn't understand each other because of the different accents. So it shows that he might have tried, but they couldn't really pull it off, at least between Ashkenazic and Sephardic. But it shows that, I mean, someone who was that adept with Hebrew as Sternharz, he could try. But it wasn't, they didn't make a habit of using it. And it's hard to say when. I mean, the myth is Eliezer Ben Yehuda, 1882, goes and tells his wife that they're only going to speak Hebrew to their child, right? And this was seen as a great Zionist heroic act, or alternatively as an abusive gesture. Because how do you speak a language that you can't speak? It's a great bafflement.
And
I feel that way when I talk to my dog in Yiddish. Yeah.
I want to thank you for illuminating the effect of Yiddish and the Hebrew language, and for that I thank you. But ultimately, for Zionism, I want to argue that there is a difference between literate language and spoken language. All your lecture was about literate language. It was written, given the text. I'm talking about mother tongue, what we talk. So in that respect, the politicality, and they murdered Yiddish. The Jewish state murdered Yiddish. I want to say that it took a lot of political... I grew up in Israel, and Tchaikovsky doing Yevgeny Onegin, Bialik doing Shakespeare, and he did, anyway, I grew up on this translation.
Yes. Of course, it was. Yeah.
It was forceful in schools.
Yes.
To bring Hebrew.
Sure.
There's no question that Yiddish and Hebrew are intertwined.
Yes. No, they say there were battles in the streets over the two languages, and of course Bialik felt, and some of the founders felt that Yiddish had to be suppressed in order to so that Hebrew could succeed. I don't think that's true, though. I think that Yiddish could have gone on as a vibrant second language of the Jews in Palestine, along with, and also Judeo-Arabic could have gone on as a third language of Jews, and Judeo-Persian as a fourth language, and Ladino as a fifth. We could have kept alternate languages alive, but because of the way the politics went, it became monolithic, and there was a... Right. Yeah. Well, I wouldn't call it a miracle. It's ingenuity, and it's ventriloquism, because basically the Jews were speaking Yiddish, and as I've tried to say, they basically breathed the breath of life of Yiddish into Hebrew, and they enabled Hebrew to become a living language by breaking down the boundary between Yiddish and Hebrew. So you could all say it in other words. That Yiddish is the dibbuk that's haunting Israeli Hebrew. Maybe that's a good place to stop. Thank you all for coming tonight. Thank you.